Welcome back, fans. We are just a few mere days away from the big night. I hope you've all made your preparations for everything. Costumes put together, candy in a big bowl, a marathon of slasher scenes, monster movies, and a few ghost stories for good measure. Now then, let me take just a quick second to let you all know that I will be attending HorrorCon VR. And so can you! All you need is a computer and Steam, and you too can come meet some of your favorite horror content creators and artists alike. I'm even hosting a panel with my wife on how you can keep an audience captive with your voice. I'll drop a link down below so you can check things out for yourself. And with that, we have our caller for the night. Go ahead, caller.
Hey, Maschino. Thanks for having me on. I hope you're having a happy Halloween. I have to ask, trick or treat?
Treat. No, trick. No, wait. Definitely treat. Final answer, treat. Yes.
Doesn't really matter what you answered. I brought a treat. Got a story here to share. It's something I wrote especially for this. Let me slip into my narrator's voice. All right. If it's okay with you, I'll stop clowning around and just get started. Okay, here we go. The Halloween Hacker. Corn stalks rose from the fields bathed in a silvery fall moonlight. It would all be harvested soon, but for now they stood out on the plains like silent soldiers in formation. Something about the sight always gave me a feeling of isolation. They blocked the view of all but the tallest silo, and to make it worse, anything could be in those fields and you'd never know it until it was right on you. Fortunately for now, I was safe in the house and only looking out at them from the rear glass door. My parents had gone off to a harvest party and wouldn't be back till later. I had stayed home because I wasn't feeling well. It was only a cold, but with all the worry about COVID, neither I nor my parents thought it would be a good idea to be out in public with a runny nose. I finished letting my dog, a German Shepherd named Cindy, in from outside. It was just her and I that night. Then closed the door and began trying to figure out what I would do with my free time. After a bit, it was pretty obvious what to do. It was what anyone would do when home alone on an autumn evening. So I turned off all the lights to prepare for watching scary movies. When I turned off the light in my bedroom, which is on the second floor and looks out over the cornfield, I thought I saw, for only a brief moment, a light, like a flashlight, coming from out in the cornrows. I told myself it was the delay of the reflection from the glass in the window or something, but it still didn't sit well with me. If I hadn't have known better, it seemed more like someone turned off their light once they saw my bedroom light go out. Still, I brushed it off as something not worthy of my attention and went to make a bag of popcorn. The black screensaver from the TV flickered into the kitchen from the living room while I eagerly awaited for my snack to be done. The moon was incredibly, almost unnaturally bright that night, and I remember thinking to myself how I could clearly see the whole backyard all the way up to the fields. The timer went off on the microwave and I turned to get my snack. Out of the corner of my eye, for just a split second, I thought I saw something on the edge of the cornrows, but when I turned to get a better look, nothing was there. Again, I brushed it off. Could have been a deer or something. We get those all the time out in the field. Cindy hadn't even started barking, so I wasn't worried. In fact, she had been quiet all night, which was unusual, but kind of a nice change. She's usually a very hyper dog that wants to play a lot. I was almost through my second movie when I got a call from my parents. I had to get up to answer it and spilled some of the popcorn. Cell phones were a big no-go in my house. My parents are pretty anti-tech. In fact, it wasn't until this epidemic hit and I had to do homeschooling that we even got a computer in the house. Dad has one out in the shop, but it's only used for work. They told me they'd be late and were having car troubles. There were some leftovers in the fridge, yada yada, usual parent stuff. Halfway back to the living room and everything went dark. Tripping over furniture, I made my way to the light switch. Nothing. The juice had been cut. Cindy wasn't barking, which greatly concerned me now, but I could still hear her heavy breathing from the couch. There was always an emergency flashlight in the junk drawer in the kitchen, so I made my way to go get it, turned it on, and went back to sit next to Cindy. As I turned the corner from the kitchen to the living room, I froze. Light from the flashlight landed on a man standing over my dog. He was pretty tall, at least 6 foot, and dressed in a blue and yellow top with red and white striped pants. He had 3 helium balloons in his left hand and a machete in his right. The heavy breathing I had heard and thought was Cindy when the lights went out. It was him from his clown mask that had a grotesquely wide smile and a red rubber nose. "Cindy," I almost said in tears. "Cindy, get him!" "Oh, don't worry about her. Slipped her something before you let her in. She isn't dead. Only taking a little cat nap," he said with a laugh. I suppose he thought it was funny that a dog was taking a cat nap, but I found it all to be too much and bolted out of the house through the back door. "Don't run. I only want to play," I heard him say as I fumbled with the lock on the door. Finally, it flipped up and I threw the door wide and sprinted to the field. "You little shit," he hissed and gave chase. Stalks of corn left tiny cuts all over as I ran. "Silent soldiers protect me now," I thought to myself and kept going until I couldn't go anymore. Crouched and panting for breath, I could still hear my assailant running around trying to find me. If only I had a cell phone I could call for help. If only Cindy hadn't been drugged, I might have a dog to fend this maniac off. But all I had was myself and miles of corn to keep me safe, and that didn't make me feel any better. Then I noticed it was quiet. There was no more crunching or pushing of corn stalks. No more man yelling at me. Not even the normal sounds of the night. "Funny being chased in a cornfield like this. I guess you could say I was stalking you," he said, and he sounded like he was right next to me. I swear I wish he had killed me before I heard that joke, but instead I ran in the opposite direction of his voice. Blood trickled down my arm from all the little cuts and my heart was pounding out of my chest. Thoughts raced through my mind if my parents would ever find me. Probably not until harvest time. And then, only when a combine drove over my dead body and tore whatever was left to shreds. "The combines," I whispered out loud to myself. They were kept in the shop. The shop had a phone. The shop was right below the tallest silo, which was the only thing I could see from the field. The red light on its top shone like a beacon, which also showed the power hadn't been cut there. "You better stop running, kid. Momo doesn't like running. It's not funny, and I'll only hurt you worse." He was still behind me and not far, judging by the sound of his voice. I was getting close now and almost there when I stopped with a jerk and my collar choked me. He had a hold of my shirt, and if it wasn't for quick thinking and me throwing my arms up so I slipped out of it, I would likely be dead by now. The corn stalks cut my bare chest as I kept on going. Dad always kept the shop locked up, but I knew there was a window that I could pry open if I had enough time. As I worked on the window, I saw Momo emerge from the field. Exhausted, he lumbered towards me with a slow, menacing gait. He was merely feet from me when I hoisted myself up, and with the help of the sweat and blood covering my body, I managed to wiggle through the window and into safety. He muttered to himself, and the sound of his footsteps on the gravel outside trailed off. Weariness washed over me, but I knew I wasn't done yet. Stumbling to my feet, I made my way to the phone inside of Dad's office and called the police. Banging came from the shop doors, and I suspected he was trying to bust the handle off. I would still have to hold out for maybe a half an hour or more until help finally arrived. Despite the dispatcher's pleas for me to remain on the line, I knew I had to find someplace better than the office to hide. There was a loft that had a retractable ladder. I could get up there, and there would be no way for him to get me then. quickly I ran to get there, but before I could make it, a loud clang rang out as the doorknob to the shop door hit the ground. Under the combine I sprang, his big clown shoes were visible, and I watched as he walked around to find me. My breath sounded like a jet engine in my ears, and I worried that he would hear it as well. Instead, he went to the office and picked up the phone, then tore it from the wall. He smashed the computer, then flipped my dad's heavy metal desk. He began to scream at the top of his lungs like a maniac. Clearly, he was pissed off. Next, he roamed around the shop for a bit, looking under things where he thought I might be hiding. As bad luck would have it, he found the cans of kerosene we keep in the back as a cheap degreaser. Cigarette smoke filled my nose, and I realized he had lit one up. Kerosene hit the floor and spread out. He went about dousing everything in the stuff. I knew it was now or never, and that I had to get out of there or be burned alive. As quietly as I could, I crept towards the door, staying under the combine as long as possible. He too was making his way towards the only exit in the shop, splashing the flammable liquid everywhere he could. It was the slowest race I've ever been in, but eventually I had to get out from under the combine, not even 5 feet from where he was standing. Just as he threw the last empty can of kerosene on the ground, I bolted for the door. He saw me and flicked the cigarette behind him as he turned to give chase. Flames erupted all over the shop. Toxic smoke choked me, but I managed to make it outside. The heat was so intense that I could still feel it even 10 feet away. Nothing could stop me though, and the light from the fire illuminated the field as I led him in a wide circle for another 5 minutes. Finally, the orange of the flames was coupled with the red and blue of police lights. Tears cascaded down my face as I ran into the arms of the first officer I found. Despite my erratic and unintelligible speech, they must have gotten the gist of what I was trying to say, and a few of them ran into the field to pursue the clown. The light from the fire made it easier to track him, and he too was exhausted from having to chase me. They had their man 10 minutes later. They told me he was known as the Halloween Hacker. He had been wanted for murdering children Halloween week since 2016, when there were all those crazy clown sightings. He was one of them and had somehow eluded police until that night. Needless to say, he's up for a life sentence and won't be hacking anyone anymore.
Now that's my kind of story, and a perfect way to end tonight's broadcast. Thanks again for the call, Monster. And thank you, lovely people, for coming back night after night. Stay safe out there.